An associated weakness in bilateral lower limb, which she said was only for the past 5 days with inability to walk. She also had an accompanying history of loss of bowel and bladder control, for which she considered in hospital outside and was catheterized, and she came to us in a post-catheterized manner. She had a history of night rays and radiation of pain to bilateral legs, but she had no history of any trauma, fever, weight loss, or any other constitution symptoms. And on clinical examination, we noted a localized tenderness over the L3, L4, and L5 region. She had no swelling, scar, or sinuses over those regions. And we attempted a passive SLR. SLRT was in around 50 degree in right side and 30 degree over the left side. On examination of power, it was noted to be 5 by 5 in L2, and it was gradually regressing from L3, L4, L5, S1, and it was around 1 by 5 in those regions. The plantar was flexor on the right side and weak in the left side. And sensation was lowered in the left side greater than the right side, especially in the L5, L4 to S1 dermatomes. On second day of admission, she developed a bilateral foot drop also. This is the initial X-ray which we took. The initial X-ray did not, the X-ray did not say, mean much to us, other than the loss of normal curvature of the lumbar region. The X-ray was not significant for any of the findings. And then owing to the status of the patient, we went on and did a MRI. And MRA revealed an hyperintense signals over the L4 vertebral level. It was panvertebral involvement with an compression over the neural foramens also. In other cases, it could be visible. There was complete neural foramen and obstruction in bilateral sites. And in these images, you can see that the L4 vertebra is completely involved. It was against the diagnosis of tuberculosis. So the initial diagnosis which we had was some pathological lesion in the L4 vertebra, and TB was not in our diagnosis, but we did PET CT, and in the PET CT they said that it is a feature suggestive of TB, mostly of infective etiology was the one which they stated, and they said that it has extension into the left sacral, left lateral recess and soft tissues with the spinal cord compression causing the features of cauda equina for the patient. And so with the initial diagnosis of L4 vertebral body pathological lesion and impending cauda equina syndrome, we went on and we did the procedure. The procedure which we did was an posterior spinal decompression from L3 to L5 level with an instrumented fusion between L2 to S2 and sacral alar screw fixation at L2, accompanied with a transpedicular biopsy at L4 vertebral level. And this was the intraoperative pictures just before dissection. And after dissection, this was the tumor mass which was noted at the L4, L3 and L5 levels. This tumor was taken biopsy. It was released. This cord was released from the structures. The other structures were knocked off, and biopsy was taken from the L4 vertebral body level. And this was a post-operative X-ray which for the procedure we did. And reports, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Mother, just before our presentation, Dr. Arvind, I just have a few questions, Dr. Arvind. Can I just ask right now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
Arvind, clinically, you weren't thinking regarding about TB at all, is it?
Ma'am, just a minute, ma'am.
Because the MRI,
yes,
the PET, everything, yeah. So what made you to think this could be a pathological lesion, or a neoplastic pathological lesion, apart from tuberculosis? What was your main clinical diagnosis to know that it is not TB and it could be more than that? What was the striking one? Because when we talked to the radiologists, they were more thinking in the terms of tuberculosis, and in fact we had called the clinicians also to know whether you have done the ESR and etc. So, but the clinicians, your consultants were more favorable to say that it's more than that. So what was that striking clinical point that could have taught you that it is more than tuberculosis? Is there anything which you would like to tell us, Dr. Arvind?
Arvind,
Sir, voice is getting. I'm not able to clear.
Arvind, can you hear me now?
Ma'am, just a minute, ma'am. Just disconnect and I'll join back, ma'am. I think some problem in my side. The voice is getting. I'm not able to get voice properly, ma'am.
Sudhir. Arvind, can you hear me? Praveen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Praveen? Praveen, are you
Yes,
there?
sir. Sudhir, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Praveen, can I answer this question and
Sudhir,
explain
sir,
all
yeah, you can go ahead, sir, because I think Arvind didn't get it, so.
okay. It works because I haven't been in this meeting. I'm Dr. Sudhir, consultant science surgeon. Actually, I was the one who saw this patient. To answer Dr. Pavitra's question, everybody they were favoring, and the diagnosis was tuberculosis only as per the MRA report and as per the initial orthopedician has seen the patient elsewhere. But there are certain points which is totally against tuberculosis. Like, for example, in the X-ray and MRI, it is a whole body involvement with the disc completely spanned. It is a very rare phenomenon or rare finding in tuberculosis. That is number one. Number two, the location of the lesion. Again, it is not very common in tuberculosis. Number three is the abscess component was very less. If we closely read the MRI, it is not the abscess, but the soft tissue lesion, which was actually encroaching into the spinal canal. And there was no paraspinal or prevertebral or epidural abscess as such. So that is again a very rare finding in tuberculosis. Though we say that, I mean, TB is a great mimicker. It can mimic like tumor also. We had tuberculosis as our last DD. But however, our first differential diagnosis was tumor. But I didn't think in terms of Ewing's, I thought more in terms of lymphoma. Because that is what we usually see in young patients, body involvement with lesion completely encroaching into the spinal canal. And finally, tuberculosis rarely presents with such gross neurological deficit with bilateral foot drop. Usually, the abscess will not result in such a gross foot drop, especially in the lumbar level. If there's a huge abscess in the lumbar level also, the dura will be able to accommodate because it is a soft lesion. Abscess is a soft lesion, and deficit due to abscess is not very common. So all these factors pointed more towards a tumorous lesion than TB, and considering the age, it could not be Mets or myeloma. So we were thinking more in terms of primary bony tumors. So immediately when the patient, when I saw the patient, I immediately asked the opinion of medical oncologist, who again saw the patient, and they also felt like they have to do tumor markers and other stuff. So in view of worsening deficit, we had no other option as to, I mean, we had to go ahead and operate the patient and decompress the dura as early as possible. So that was the thought process. Intraoperatively, I was like almost 100% sure that it was tumor because there were tissue. It was a friable vascular tissue. There was no caseating necrosis. There was no pus at all. And TB usually will be able to make out intraoperatively. And there was extensive bony destruction. The bone was completely empty or hollow. I wasn't able to put even a single screw into the bone. Whereas in TB, it is usually heterogeneous abscess, so some part of marrow will be retained and will be able to get some hold with the screw. So it was a hollow bone with gross destruction, and it was a friable tumorous tissue. That's why I personally called up the pathologist and I told that it is not looking like TB, though the PET-CT and the MRI features were suggestive of tuberculosis.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. It was well explained. Thank you, sir. Mother, you can go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. With the above said history, we have received specimen SL967-2020, and it was multiple fragments of gray white to gray brown tissue measuring 1.5 by 1 by 0.3 centimeter, and A was labeled as soft tissue and B was a bony tissue, and the tissues were all embedded. This is the whole moon view of the slide showing multiple fibrocollagenous tissue, and here we can see in one focus there are the infiltration of the blue clot cells. So this is the soft tissue showing infiltration by the blue cells around the adipose tissue, and this is the LOPA view of the slide showing multiple uniform round blue cells which are infiltrating around the adipocyte. On further HIPAA, we can see that these cells are uniform small round cells with hyperchromatic nuclei and the scanned cytoplasm and fine chromatin. And this is the bony fragment which showed bony tissue here, and blue cells are present around near to that bony fragment. So this is the HIPAA view to show that same uniform round cells, round blue cells which are present. This is to show this in HIPAA we can see this individual cells are uniform round with having a round oval nuclei with the hyperchromatic nuclei and having a scanned cytoplasm. So with this, we gave the differential diagnosis of small round blue cell tumor and lymphoma for this stage. So we proceeded with further markers. That is, it turned out to be Y-mentin and Fly1 positive and negative for CD45 and SOXTIN and INSM1. CD45 is done to rule out the lymphoma and INSM1 for the neuroendocrine marker. So we gave the final diagnosis. HNE and IHC features are in favor of Ewing sarcoma and advise the molecular studies for further categorization. So the patient, FFP specimen is sent for the FISH analysis and the sample is positive for EWSR1 translocation. So this confirms that the patient had Ewing sarcoma. So moving on to the discussion proper. Ewing sarcoma, it is a small round blue cell tumor and it is a malignant bone tumor, mostly uniform primitive small round cells without any obvious differentiation. So it affects 6-10% of the primary malignant tumors and most common in the children and young adults after osteosarcoma. And the age group affected is less than 20 years of age and male is to female proton is 1.4:1. It usually arises in the diaphysis of the long tubular bones, and the site will be diaphysis or metadiaphyseal of the long bones, and it can also occur in the pelvis and ribs, skull, vertebra, scapula, and short tubular bones of hand and feet, and 10-20% can be extraskeletal. So the pathogenesis is, it is a balanced translocation between EWSR1 gene on chromosome 22 and Fly1 gene on chromosome 11. So the translocation 11-22 will be identified, and EWSR1 Fly1 fusion gene will cause EWS Fly1 protein. So clinically, the patient usually presents as a pain. Pain is the most common symptom. Mass may or may not be seen, and pathological fracture will be present, and intermittent fever and anemia. Radiologically, it is an ill-defined osteolytic lesion, and you can see permeative bones restriction, periosteal reaction, and soft tissue extension. We can see the moth-eaten bone restriction associated with the onion skin. So grossly, we can see whitish-gray soft tissue mass present in the marrow spaces. Necrotic and hemorrhagic areas will be seen. Periosteum will be elevated and is often perforated. Large soft tissue mass extend beyond the bony boundaries and it is a knot encapsulated in which the surrounding soft tissue and muscle. So microscopically, we can see an undifferentiated uniform small round cells with round nuclei and a fine chromatin. And sometimes it try to form the rosette formation. So there are two types of Ewing sarcoma. The first one is a classical Ewing sarcoma. Here we can see the vaguely lobular pattern and cleared out cytoplasm, and that is due to secondary to the glycogen deposits. This glycogen deposits can be demonstrated with the PA is positive. Whereas in atypical Ewing sarcoma, the cells will be bit medium to large size, and that they will have the prominent nucleoli. So immunohistochemistry to confirm Ewing sarcoma, it is will be CD19 will be diffuse membrane positivity, Fly1 will be nuclear staining positive, and NKX2.2 is a recently developed IHC marker for Ewing sarcoma. So the differential will be small cell osteosarcoma. The one which differentiates osteosarcoma from the evening sarcoma, here we have the malignant osteoid which produces the blue cells. So this is how the evening sarcoma will differentiate from the small cell osteosarcoma. And primary bone lymphoma, we'll see the monomorphous population of the lymphocytes will be present as a sheets. So undifferentiated small round cell sarcoma, we have Ewing sarcoma, CIC rearranged sarcoma, round cell sarcoma, EWSR1 non-ETS and sarcoma with the BCAR alteration. In Ewing sarcoma, this is a classical type, atypical type, adamantinoma like Ewing sarcoma. And in CIC rearranged sarcoma, we'll have a lobular architecture, round cell, necrosis will be seen, and mitotic activity will be brisk. Whereas round cell sarcoma, EWSR1 non-ETS will have spindle or round, fibromyxohyaline stroma will be seen. In sarcoma with BCOR alteration, it will be round spindle, nesting or fascicles and rich capillary network. So the marker to differentiate, Ewing sarcoma will be positive for CD99, NKX2.2, FLY1 and ERG. Whereas CIC rearranged sarcoma will be positive for CD99, calreticulin, ERG, but it will be negative for NKX2.2, SNRET and myogenic markers. Round cell sarcoma, it will be positive for CD99 and desmin myogenin will be positive, SNRET and SOX10 will be positive. Whereas sarcoma with BCOR alteration, it will be BCOR, SAT-B2 positive and cyclin D1 positive. So the criteria for the undifferentiated small round cell sarcoma, we have the essential criteria and decidable criteria. In essential criteria, for Ewing's is, it is a small round cell, uniform population, and it will be CD99 positive, and it will have desirable criteria will be FET or ETS fusion will be seen. Whereas CIC rearranged sarcoma, the essential will be small round cell, CD99, WT1 and ETV4 positive, whereas the desirable will be CIC gene rearranged. Round cell sarcoma, EWSR1 non-ETS, will have the spindle or round cell, and it will be low-grade fibrohyaline stroma, and it will have EWSR1 NF80C2 fusion. And desirable will be, if it is a long bone, NAF2C2 will be seen, and PATZ1 will be divergent phenotypic myogenic and neurogenic IHC. With sarcoma with BCOR alteration, will have the round or spindle cell, and it will be arranged in nest or sheets of fascicles, and it will have a mixed stroma and delicate texture. It will be positive for first SAT-B2 and cyclic B1. The desirable will be BCAR fusion and BCAR IgG. So based on the age, site and prognosis, Ewing's will be more common in less than 20 years, whereas CIC rearranged sarcoma will be positive in children or young adults, but it is deep soft tissue, that is 10% visceral and 5% of the bone. And the round cell sarcoma with EWSR1, NAFTC2 means it is children and more common in the male, and PATZ1 means it is older. So NAFTC2 is more common in the bone and PATZ1 will be more common in the soft tissue. Whereas sarcoma with the BCAR alteration, CCNBC mutation means it is seen in children more than 90% of less than 20 years. And if it is a soft tissue, it will be CCNB3 and it is response to the Ewing sarcoma chemotherapy. So any undifferentiated round cell sarcoma, if it is a bone or soft tissue, first we have to proceed with the CD45 to rule out lymphoma. If it is CD45 negative, we have to proceed with the CD99 and the FISH EWSR breakup part. So if it is CD99 negative, then we can rule out Ewing sarcoma. Like a patch or dot-like positivity, it can be CIC rearranged sarcoma or sarcoma with BCAR genetic alteration. If it is CD99 positive, if it is a diffuse membranous positive, we have to proceed with NKS2.2. And if it is positive, it confirms Ewing sarcoma, that is FLY1, ERG, SNRET. And if it is variable, it can be sarcoma with EWSR1 or non-ETS fusion. So prognosis based on the age, if it is less than 10 years or 10 to 17 years, it is a favorable prognosis. Whereas unfavorable prognosis, more than 18 years, and if the tumor is confined to the distal extremity or proximal extremity, it has a good prognosis. And if it is pelvis, it has an unfavorable. And based on the size, if it is less than 8, it carries a good prognosis. And non-metastatic tumor also carries a good prognosis. That's it, ma'am. Thank you, Madhu.
Thank you.
So, Madhu, you just highlighted the newer classification for the undifferentiated small cell tumors, right? So why was the newer classification had come into the... Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so why did this have a classification... What is the role it's playing? Why do they have to classify it as an Ewing sarcoma, CIC, ETS?
Because we have Ewing's like sarcoma, the classification had come, ma'am. And
they had to break down for CIC and BCOR because there is something called treatment for the purpose of the treatment and for the prognostication. So that's why the molecular plays an important role in identifying the tumors for the tumors which have been desirable for the treatment and for prognostication. So that's why those four circles have just recently been updated.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Actually, regarding this case, we initially received the A sample. I think when it goes with it just started with the clinical history and radiology. So when initially, as pathologies, we also thought it could be something to do with lymphocytes and plasma cells. But since the A sample was totally fresh, we weren't able to define the architecture or define the tumor cells to what it could belong to. So we waited for the second sample to arrive, and that second sample had this monotonous sheet, what Dr. Madhumita had rightly pointed out in our slides, those tumor cells. So then we gave a DD of it could be a small round blue cell tumor, which consists of Ewing's or lymphoma. So then we had to go through the IHCs, and fortunately, Fly1 was positive. But since those four circles, which Dr. Madhu had discussed, regarding for the treatment and prognostication purpose, we had to check for next generation sequencing for the molecular samples to find out what exactly it is. But unfortunately, since the tumor cells were totally crushed, they weren't able to extract the DNA. So we had to send the sample for FISH and get it confirmed for EWS-R1 and Fly1 probe. And now it's been confirmed that the patient has Ewing sarcoma with Fly1 mutation. So that's from the pathology side. So, may I know what the
outcome?
May I know how the patient is doing now and what is the treatment?
Post-operatively, patient came for a follow-up after 3 weeks, ma'am. Actually, she is now walking without walker support, ma'am. The power has increased to 4+, ma'am, in bilateral lower limbs. She is getting chemotherapy in oncology department. Other than that, clinically, she's doing better, ma'am.
So how many cycles are they planning? Any idea?
No, ma'am. They have given 3 cycles, but they haven't said anything confirmly, ma'am.
They are planning 18 cycles.
Okay. And how often would you monitor her, Sudhir? I mean...
The usual follow-up is suture removal, 1, 3, 6 months, 1 year. By 1 year, everything should have been consolidated. And after 1 year, if she is fine, yearly once for 5 years, or else again 6 months once, till it gets consolidated.
Okay. Very interesting case, actually.
A very interesting case. One thing which I want to highlight for the postgraduates as well as others in this forum is, whenever you have a doubt, especially to the ortho postgraduates here, whenever you have a doubt of if something is not fitting into the box, then I think you have to personally go and talk to the respective department or the respective doctors. So here I asked Aravind to monitor, and Aravind actually, he communicated with the pathologist, and I spoke to the pathologist in charge directly twice. So, and finally, we were able to come to a conclusion, because sometimes these kind of cases can be easily missed and can be, we can have some other diagnosis and we have been beating around the bush instead of giving the right treatment. So I think communication part is very, very important. So if you have any doubt, just make sure that you just talk to the respective departments in person. So that is very important.
As far as pathology is concerned, for ortho cases, without discussion with the clinician, ideally we are not even supposed to give the diagnosis. That's what our textbooks say. So what Dr. Sudhir is saying is, 100% true, 200% true. Dr. Menon, sir, would you like to say something, sir? Dr. Menon?
I think what Dr. Sudhir is saying is absolutely right, because not only that, the interest generated, make sure that we get the best out of both the departments. So
yes.
I think that is important.
Yes.
But the other thing I wanted to just know is there a possibility that the histopathologically it can be construed as an infection?
Pavitra?
I'd asked this question earlier also once, if I remember right, because I had a patient who had a bony Ewing sarcoma. It was reported by the pathologist as infection.
Mistakenly, yeah, sir. It is literature. It has been reported. Pavitra, what is your take on that? Because
yes, sir.
In literature, there have been reports like this, sir. Many times it can be missed. Yeah, Pavitra, go on.
Especially, sir, in Ewing sarcoma, there are reports that sometimes the ESR will be also elevated.
Mm.
So that's why we repeatedly kept asking whether the ESR is elevated or not.
Yes.
ESR is elevated or not.
Yes.
There are reports to say that in Ewing's, especially in Ewing's, where there is a contradiction that an ESR is elevated and it hides the diagnosis of the real Ewing sarcoma behind.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, but because.
Histopathologically, sir, we generally cannot miss it if the lesion is hit. That's true, sir. So if the lesion has been correctly taken, we cannot miss the small blue cells in Ewing sarcoma. If it is somewhere close to the lesion, hovering around the lesion, maybe there might be. But if you have hit the lesion and we have processed the correct tissue, histopathologically, I don't think we can actually miss it unless it's a really, that would be a gross mistake, sir.
Would it be labeled as an infection?
You mean
would there be any other features? Because why I'm asking this is we had the same problem here itself.
Okay.
Twice and a biopsy was done. One was done outside, one was done subsequently. Both came as infection, but the third time a biopsy was done, it came as Ewing's.
Sir, highly unlikely, sir, in the sense that if the infection area is taken somewhere peripheral, it might this thing. But if you have hit the lesion, it's highly impossible. It's not possible that we would miss Ewing sarcoma because it has a very distinct histopathological appearance. Pavitra, you would want something on this?
Sir, in this biopsy, actually, initially, we weren't able to make the architecture because it was totally distorted. If you could have seen Dr. Madhumita's slides, it was totally a crushed tumor cells which we initially received. And we weren't able to make at all the architecture, but by God's grace, the second sample which was sent, that is the tumor B sample,
just open it up again.
A lot of tumor cells, a monotonous sheets, which led us to the diagnosis of a small round blue cell tumor.
Madhu, can you just show that first?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. So the sampling matters here a lot, sir.
No, obviously sampling will matter, but what I was trying to say is two different set of surgeons have sampled it at two different periods of time.
Okay.
And so I was a little concerned because the second sampling apparently, everything is done under C imaging, obviously.
Okay.
It is done under X-ray imaging. We don't like to do an open biopsy. So, but it is done under C imaging. And that's what we can get the biopsies from.
Correct.
But both the times, I could have understood if it was reported as a diagnosis could not be made, which would have said the sample tissue is not adequate or it's not representative or anything like that.
Okay.
But both times it came as infection.
Infection. Oh, okay, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. So the thing is.
Yeah, it is. Correct. Quite a quite a controversy. Is this the one, Madhu? Is this the one, the first biopsy? What is this one, Madhu?
Yes, ma'am. This is the soft
tissue. Yes, ma'am. This was the very first biopsy what we received.
Okay. Okay. So this hardly shows anything. Okay. Then just move on. Go to the high part.
We received at the same time, but B had to wait because of the decal, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. And then the subsequent one?
This is the bony one, ma'am.
Okay.
This is the bony fragment which had the...
This is the bony bit.
The tentative report initially came as chronic inflammatory reaction. So then I discussed with the pathologist and I told that I actually took samples from the soft tissue lesion as well as from the bone.
Okay.
I told them that
the lesion is going, Sudhir. See, the soft tissue, Pavitra, soft tissue lesion did not show anything.
Or exactly.
What yeah, so the correct. Bone didn't show.
Correct. So I told them to have a deeper look in the bone because, I mean, usually when you take the soft tissue, it will be very, very friable and it will be vascular. It will be bleeding. So I'll be using bipolar and cauterizing it and taking it. So bony, usually we won't have the tissue. We'll just take the bone pieces, the marrow. So then we had this diagnosis from the bony bit after 2 days. Yeah.
So Madhumita, do you have a hyper of the same bony bit?
This one, ma'am.
So I think, yes, sir, if it is from the soft tissue, as you said, there might be some...
It is from the bone, if I remember right, because it was done under X-ray control in the theater. A biopsy was taken under X-ray control. And it was bony pieces, because soft tissue, we cannot take it without under X-ray control. We need to do it either in a CT scan or ultrasound.
Then it must have been missed, sir, somewhere. Because ideally, we cannot confuse that.
Do you think, will the tumor markers also will be negative, obviously, if there's no tumor tissue there, isn't it?
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely, sir. The tumor tissue is only, the marker will be positive only if the tumor cells are there. Otherwise, it will show just negative, that's it. If it is positive somewhere, some patch there, we can still detect it. The tumor markers are negative, that means that particular area does not have tumor. But I think, as you said, very rightly pointed out, sir, these lesions have to be discussed and, you know, because bone lesions can be very tricky. Many lesions now show the same kind of IHC staining also. Without discussion, we are also very scared to give any bony lesion. You know, so lesions can be very overlapping. So I think as against all other systems, I think ortho for us, it is very clearly mentioned the textbook, do not give any diagnosis without clinical discussion and X-ray findings. Because somewhere it can be missed.
Ewing's tumor radiologically also, it's very difficult to differentiate from
infection. Absolutely. Yes.
So at the end of the day, it's the pathologist who tells us which it's infection or not. And
the typical onion skinning may not be seen. I don't know whether how often you see that, sir. They say that onion skinning of the
onion peel, and when it's classical, everyone knows about it.
Ah, yes.
So there's no question. It is only when it is not so classical that it's difficult.
That it becomes wrong. Yes. True. Absolutely true. Yeah, very nice. Only one case, Pavitra, or do we have any more?
Ma'am, that's it, ma'am. I think that.
Okay. So likely that this might do well, isn't it, Sudhir? I mean, how is the usual prognosis of the patient in general with regard to the outcome and long-term? I can't hear you, Sudhir. Your voice is breaking.
Yeah, can you hear me now, ma'am? Clinically presented with near complete foot drop. And after surgery, on third or fourth post-operative day itself, the power improved to grade 3+. We have a video of that also. We documented it. And now her neurology is almost normal. She's walking without walker support. From spine point of view, neurological point of view, she is doing extremely well. And that is the importance of the fixation. Just one more point for the ortho PGs here. The S2 ALR iliac screws, which we have put, it acts literally like a pillar. So since L5 entire body was hollow and involved, if you put S2 ALR iliac screw, we can make the patient walk the next day itself. Whereas if you had used any other modes of fixation like S1, you cannot make the patient walk. It will completely collapse. So that is why we had to put S2 ALR iliac screw, and the patient is mobilizing and she's doing extremely well. I spoke with pediatric oncologist also. He said that since there is no metastasis in this patient, the prognosis is relatively good. So I hope she'll do well. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I think. Thank you so much, sir. Any other queries, sir?
No, nothing.
Thank you so much, Dr. Menon. Very yes. Nice, actually. These are things that need to be, you know, brainstormed. For us also to learn both ways, I think.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pavitra. Very nicely.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Have a good presentation. Thank you. Thank you.